Well, good morning, Riverside Church. Can we stand together? We're so glad that you're here with us this morning, whether you're here with us in person or online. Just come together and worship the Lord, for he is good and greatly to be praised.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Come on.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
Come on.
That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Whoa, Jesus, I sing for
for grace this morning. So grateful.
As the Spirit was moved.
come rest on us. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you feel me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart.
Make this our prayer.
Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want. Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want.
Behold the Father's heart, the mystery he lavishes on us as deep cries out to deep, oh, how desperately he wants us. The things of earth stand next to him like a candle to the sun. Unfailing Father, what compares to his great love? Behold his holy Son, the Lion and the Lamb given to us. The Word became a man that my soul should know its Savior. Forsaken for the sake of all mankind, salvation in his blood. Jesus Messiah, the righteous died for us. It wasn't all.
Oh,
He who was and is to come, prepare the way until the work on earth is done. Watch as a cloud he rides, swing low, lift up the sound as he makes our praise his throne. Behold the
Ken Burnside. This is my wife Debbie, and we have been married forever. We're going to be doing communion this morning, and most of you know how to do the packets, but take the top tab off with a wafer and then the second tab for the juice. Debbie and I have hold a monthly ministry in the community of Fiddlesticks, but we are very happy and proud to call Riverside our home.
In the Old Testament, the prophet Isaiah wrote and prophesied over 700 years before Jesus was even born. Over 2,000 years have passed, and millions around the world will gather just as we have today to celebrate and remember what he did for us.
Isaiah 53:5, but he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought peace was upon him, by his wounds we are healed.
Today is Father's Day, and we are about to honor our most heavenly Father by worshiping him through the sharing of communion as a community. Because everything that we do unto him in love and submission is a form of worship. We as a body of believers, as Riverside Church, will share in this most beautiful gift of remembrance that our heavenly Father gave us through his Son, Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world so much, with an unending and abundant, immeasurable love, that he sent his one and only begotten Son to walk this earth as both God and man, experiencing everything that we experience as human beings, and yet living this earthly life without sin. He sent Jesus to reconcile us back to himself and to heal the broken relationship that sin had caused. And because we are lovers and followers of Jesus and truth believers in Jesus, we will share in this last directive that Jesus left for us on the night before he died. So we pray that everyone here who will be taking communion this morning will please search their heart. We do not take communion out of perfection, but we do take it as a remembrance, and with a grace-filled humility of knowing the great cost which Jesus suffered and what he accomplished on the cross. We should take it with a heart that is filled with joy and thanksgiving. We also want to remember, on both sides of the stage here, there are empty chairs. These open seats represent people, family, friends, and neighbors dear to our hearts, who have not yet found the truth, love, joy, and peace of following Christ. So we continue to lift them up to the Lord and never give up praying for them. On the night before Jesus was betrayed, he gathered up in a little room with his disciples, and they shared a meal, but it was unlike any that they had shared before. It says in Matthew 26,
while they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body. Let's all take this together, please. Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.
So as we go about our day today, as we leave here and go out into our week, let us remember.
From John 6:33, for the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives to the world.
We stand and worship.
Beautiful.
name it is. God, we thank you for this day you've given to us, a day that we can rejoice and be glad in it, Lord. A day that we can celebrate you because you are good and you are mighty, you are strong, you are generous. Lord, you are King of kings and Lord of lords, and today we just celebrate that. And it's in your name that we pray. And all God's people said, somebody turn to somebody and say, Happy Father's Day.
Good morning, Riverside Church. We are so excited that you chose to spend part of your weekend with us. Before we continue in our service, I have just a couple of announcements for you. If you miss any of the things I mention, visit the 411 page at riversidechurch.org, or if you're here in our auditorium, you can scan the QR code on the seat in front of you to download the Riverside app or stop by Next Steps in the lobby. Speaking of the lobby, did you know you have an opportunity to get a fresh, hot, or cold cup of coffee every Sunday? And it's not just the coffee that you can buy from the grocery store. We have a relationship with the farmers in Guatemala who grow the beans, and they're roasted right here in Lee County. If you want to take some of this coffee home, you totally can. Just stop by the lobby and let them know, and they'll grab a bag for you. The best part of this is all of the money goes to our local and international missions partners who are spreading the gospel and making disciples of Jesus. In this year, you guys have already donated over $2,000 to two of our missions partners. And this month, all of the proceeds are going to Haven of Hope, the orphanage in Bolivia that our student ministry just came back from. Find out all of the information on our 411 page. We here at Riverside believe that prayer is plan A. And whether you know it or not, we have a group that meets on our campus every Tuesday afternoon to pray for each and every one of you, as well as specific requests. If you want to join that team or have us pray over certain things, you can visit the 411 page to submit your request or find out the information about that meeting. That's all I have for you, Riverside. Y'all take care.
Wow, isn't that amazing what the coffee ministry is doing? Isn't that pretty amazing? That's pretty awesome. Yeah, you give them a round of applause. And, you know, be sure that when you go out there next time, just to really thank them, because, you know, oftentimes working back there can be kind of a grind. Thank you. It is Father's Day, if you did not know that, and I am known a little bit for my top-tier humor is what my son would call it. So happy Father's Day to everyone. Welcome. We're so glad that you're here. If you're a father, raise your hand. Or if you have so many, you know what, I've got kids all over the country. Is that a surprise to you? Because I've been in ministry for so long, there's so many kids that I have had that have, I feel like they're dads. And it's, I know that everyone here probably has those people in their life. So if you're a dad or if you have been a father figure to someone, would you just stand? Would you just stand? We just want to say thank you and honor you for just a moment. Thank you so much. And in honor of you guys, when you leave today, I think they're going to have hot dogs out there. I think there's like a blow-up axe thing like that. And you know what? I wanted to honor you as well with a few more wonderful jokes. So just real quick, why did the golfer bring two pairs of pants? In case he got a hole in one. There you go. How do you stop a bull from charging? You take away his credit card. Okay, one more. Why do seagulls fly over the sea? If they flew over the bay, they would be bagels. So those are really, really bad, but, you know, I got the laugh, and so that really all that matters. We're so thankful that y'all are coming today, and it's just going to be an awesome day of worship and just celebration, and Steve's going to bring a message here in just a moment. But before we do that, I wanted to just remind you that this is normally a time in our service where I would just say something about offering and giving something and being generous. And I just want to share just a quick story about my dad, who was one of the most generous guys in the world. In fact, the last time I ever saw my dad was at a father-son banquet, and 3 days later, he passed away. But he passed so many great things on to me and passed on legacy, And that's the importance of being a dad, is passing on legacy and passing on faith and really building into your children and those who you call children. And the one generosity story from him, every Easter, probably for like 6 or 7 years, he would wake us, I have a brother, he would wake us boys up at the crack of dawn, and he would say, all right, boys, let's go. And we get on our finest clothes, and we would go to a place called the Stella Fuller Settlement. And that place was a place where they would feed the hungry, and they would clothe the people who needed something. And I grew up in a very poor area, Huntington, West Virginia. And so I can remember going down there and feeding them breakfast, passing out clothes. And those are the moments that I remember from my father, who has taught me more about generosity, not just about giving my money and resources, but giving my time towards things that are needed. God says, and Jesus says, that the poor we will always have with us, and we need to remember the poor and to feed the poor and share with the poor. And that's the generosity that my dad has definitely passed on to me. And I bet each of you can probably think of things that your dad has passed on to you in that area. So be thinking about that, and you can give online, you can give via text, you can write a check. There are tons of ways to give here at this church, but we love not only ministering to those people here in the Fort Myers area, but there are people all over the world that we share with, and so that's what your generosity supports. And so we're so thankful for that, and so I'm just going to pray, and then Steve's going to come up, and he's going to share the word. God, we thank you for the day. We thank you for your love. We thank you for dads, and we thank you for the love that they share with us. And so, Lord, we're thankful that we get to be in this place today to hear your word. Lord, I pray it would penetrate our hearts to those places that need penetrated. Lord, I pray that you would soften our hearts, ready to hear your word, Lord, that we would not walk out of here the same as which we came in. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
So when you see Mike Parker up here without a guitar, get nervous, as he may tell. It's fun to watch you guys get to know the Mike Parker we know in staff meetings, where those puns are really hard to stop. He's really, really quick, too. So anyway, today is Father's Day. So happy Father's Day. It's also Juneteenth. Do you know about Juneteenth? This was when we lived in Texas. We learned all about Juneteenth there. I think this, for reasons, the celebration started there. But it seems like there was something else today I was supposed to. Today is my 29th wedding anniversary. So we've been married almost as long as you guys. No? So I thought I'd stick that in there so you can embarrass Wendy when you see her. Let me pray for us and we'll jump into the word. Father, I'm grateful for time to gather and worship, for so many faces and voices that help lead us in time to just process who you are, to pause for communion, to sing these words back to you, to catch up on what's going on in your church. And Lord, we're just grateful for your word, and we ask that you speak to us from it. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to age myself here just a little bit. I remember when my mom and my sisters upgraded their hair dryers. It was 1977-ish. Not sure if we ever quite had one of these, but I remember this in our house. And I remember when they threw it out and upgraded to the state-of-the-art 1977. I heard some oohs and ahs. Y'all remember when these came out? Things changed, I guess. I don't have that problem. But it meant, because this was now discarded, I could have it. This is why I remember this. That meant I could take it apart and see how it worked, which I did right away. And then one day I decided I would put that thing back together. But for some reason, because I was probably 9 or 10 years old, I was pretty sure I needed a fan, but not the heater part. I don't know why I thought it. I needed a fan with a hose on it, but I took effort to take the heating element out and wire it back together. I may have forgotten that part at that age, and then to test it. So I was gonna need to plug it in, which I wasn't stupid. I was 9 or 10. I wasn't gonna just go plug it in inside. I would do it outside. And so I got my plug in my hand and I approached the outlet. This was the 1970s, so we were taught, this was everywhere when I was a kid, that electricity is dangerous. You can die from this stuff. So this, in my life, would have been a great moment to pause and maybe even get my dad before I tried plugging that in the wall. You ever have a moment where the right thing to do would have been to ask for help? Or maybe even to get your dad? Why don't you ask when those moments come? I get that your dad may not have been the one that you turned to. Maybe you're afraid you're going to get in trouble if you ask, especially if you're about to start a fire. Or maybe your dad was supportive, but you were kind of arrogant and you just wanted to try it on your own. Or maybe your dad wasn't there. And so you didn't go to dad. Maybe he was hard to please, or maybe you built up an image in your head of how he might react and how he might stop you instead of helping you. Or maybe you thought he'll just end up giving me a lecture or shame or a cold shoulder, or that he'll overreact or get mad at you. I would argue that the things that made many of us resist going to our dads for help are often the same things that make you resist going to God for help when you need him. And maybe somewhere you started to question whether or not you could trust him, or you're not sure if he'll be there, or you're not sure if he really cares. So if you got a Bible, turn to Matthew chapter 7. So Matthew's the New Testament, the second half that explains the coming of Jesus. First book there, so Matthew. So if you're scrolling, you can download one of these. The Bible app is awesome. There's free Bibles out in the lobby. You can grab those. We'll use them a lot in this room. I know we want you reading these on your own in your life, but I get that sometimes life gets away, so we'll make sure we have some time when you're here that we read this together and we work through it. In Matthew 7, Jesus is speaking to a crowd, and he's going to ask them a couple of questions. They're kind of silly questions because he's going to answer a much bigger question for them. And he's going to set up some rhetorical questions, some obvious questions, so that he can help them answer, what kind of father is God? What's he like? What's the father like? What's God like? And so I'll have a list of four things. If you want to make a list, you can. We'll start at Matthew chapter 7, verse 7. Jesus says to this crowd, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. I remember lectures in school where the teacher would say, please save your questions until the end. Do you remember that? I hated that, because that meant I need to write them down, because I had questions. I had questions all the time. If I didn't have questions, I would ask questions for other people. You remember that kid in the class? The shy kids would whisper things to me, or friends who were nervous about it would pass me a note, and then I would ask the question because I didn't care if I looked like an idiot, because you never knew what you might learn. And so as soon as questions came, my hand would just shoot up, and it may have been anything. Now, I know that maybe you wait until the end and you don't just interrupt with a question, but do you have questions? Do you ever find you got questions with God? Did life teach you not to ask them? Or to put them on a shelf, or to not rock the boat? You ever have an adult yell at you, stop asking so many questions? God's not like that. Jesus just told us that. God's a patient father. Ask, seek, knock. He doesn't mind. As a matter of fact, Jesus said it will be given to you. Ask. Not only can you ask him and is he patient, but he'll answer. He answers. He's a willing father. He's willing that you have the things that you need. It's not a promise that he'll give you whatever you ask for. He says, ask. He'll answer. He'll do things for you. He answers those who ask. He meets those who seek. He opens the door to those who knock. So this is in the book of Matthew. If you go over two books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, in Luke, Jesus taught a very similar thing. Luke records a different time when he taught the same message, but he taught it this time just to his disciples. And one of them had asked him, the Lord, teach us to pray. And so he taught them the Lord's Prayer. Do you know that? You know, some of you grew up in church knowing this, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Have you ever heard that? So that's where he taught it. They asked him, teach us to pray. And then he told a story. And he told a story about a guy who had gone asleep. And the guy had gone asleep with his whole family. At that time, they probably were in one room, and people would be in the floors and their mats and things. And to get from one side of the room to the other, you'd have to tiptoe through that. So this guy had gone to sleep with his family, and his friend knocked on his door at midnight. Now, culturally, I know you have friends who text you at midnight. That happens in our house because not everybody in our house turns their phone off like I do, and it wakes everybody up. When was the last time, though, you have a friend who knocked on your door at midnight? People here might shoot you. You got to be careful whose door you knock on at midnight. But if it's an emergency and it's a friend, you get up, right? In the story Jesus told, it wasn't an emergency. This guy had guests, and he was out of bread. So at midnight, he goes and knocks on his friend's door. And I get, in the culture, hospitality was a big deal. It was important to not be caught unprepared, and this would be embarrassing for him if he couldn't feed his friend. But if I am asleep, and all my kids and my wife are asleep, and we live in a one-room house, and you knock at midnight because you want bread for your guests, because you didn't plan, right? This is the story Jesus is telling. He said this happened, this guy knocks on the door, but here was Jesus' point. He knocks on the door at midnight, he asks for bread, he's woken up your whole family, but you do it. You'll get up and give him bread. Not because he's your friend, but just because of the audacity. I can't believe you're asking for bread in the midnight. Do you have any bread? Fine, take the bread. I've done this. Haven't you done this? When a friend was that audacious, and you're surprised when you do it. It's like, wait, I just gave it to him. I couldn't believe he would ask for something like that. You know what a bolt snap is? Here's one of those little scuba diving things. These are super popular for divers because you can hook stuff to stuff, but it doesn't like open easily, so like a rope can get tangled up in things. They're expensive. These things are like $12 a piece. I bought one one day, and I was kind of excited because I had a bolt clip. I thought, I'm going to blow $12 on this, and I'll have one of these. And I got home, and I showed my friend at home. I said, look what I got. And my friend, my daughter, said, cool. And then she said, can I have it? What? This is the first one I bought myself. Yes, you can have it. I gave it to her, which is the story, like Jesus said. You get up and answer because the question's so audacious. And then Jesus says, this is in progress, teach them to pray. He tells that story, and then he says, ask, and it'll be given to you. Seek, you'll find. Knock, it will be open to you. Because God's the kind of Father where you can be audacious, where your timing can be bad, where you can fail to plan and come unprepared and still knock on the door at midnight. You can go to him. You can knock at midnight and he will answer the door. He not only answers, he opens the door. He's patient. He's willing. He's willing for you to ask, to seek, to knock. Have you been doing that? Have you been knocking? Those of you who don't know him, it's a great place to start. You just knock on the door. God, are you there? Just knock on the door. Ask him. What do you got to lose by asking him if he's real? You have a lot to gain, I would argue. Jesus' story, he implies you can do it at midnight when you might worry about waking the whole family and being rude. He said you can knock loudly. You can knock at midnight and wake everybody up. God is patient. You can come whenever you need to come. You can come at the wrong time. You can come in the wrong way. Just knock. And Jesus says God will answer. He will open the door. Some of you need to do that now. Jesus says if you knock, God will let you in. So if you've been waiting, what are you waiting for? He tells us this is the kind of Father he is. You wake him up at midnight. Not that God sleeps. He's just using the human story to explain. You don't have to like weigh your words or come with a careful plan or write a note ahead of time. Hey, can I be there at midnight on Thursday? You can just go in the moment straight to him. If you've been seeking, looking for the truth, knocking, seeking, asking God, if you seek, Jesus says you'll find. Ask C.S. Lewis about that. Have you ever read his book, Mere Christianity? It's great as an audio book recorded. Well, it wasn't recorded back then, but he wrote it in the 40s, I think. Is that right? 40s, 50s, around there. 40s. Part of it will recount his story of seeking and how God found him in that. More recent version, Lee Strobel's, similar thing. He actually was seeking to disprove it, and he ends up finding out that Jesus is real, and it changes his life. It's great accounts like this. You can ask some of the people in this room. There are people in here who sought, who started asking, and they found him. And some of them would say, actually, he found them. You need to figure out how that works. There's a both and there, I think. You knock, you seek, you can ask. If you've been asking, too, do you go to God when you're in trouble? Are you unprepared? I think sometimes we see him as the father who we're scared to go to instead of realizing, no, I'm going to need dad's help. I need it now. When you're thinking about plugging in a contraption that you made without knowing what's going to happen and how you have no electrical skills when you're 10 years old, but you're about to step forward, do you ask or you just do it? You just go ahead with life and your plan in all the 50 or 30 or 40 years you've lived and think, I know everything I need to know about life. Or do you ask first? Hey, Maker, Father, Creator, Eternal One, who actually is wise. Let me ask you before I step forward. When you don't know what to do, or when you're embarrassed, or when you need help, do you ever hesitate to ask God for help? Because you project your worst fears on God? You think he might be like somebody you knew who wasn't there? Or maybe you know somebody who made fun of you when you needed help, and you think, well, maybe God's going to be like that. In verse 9, Jesus talks about that. He says, which one of you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? What kind of jerk does that? This is one of my favorite passages in the Bible. It's like this is the God is not a jerk passage. So I think sometimes we start to form these ideas, and Jesus is like, why would you think he's like that? Who, if your kid needs food, who of you would give him a rock or a snake? There's some mean dads out there. I mean, I know that you may have slipped in a snake somewhere. It's not that. Your kid's hungry. You give him a rock to eat. What kind of jerk does that? Everybody knows this is a jerk move, right? And we learned to live with snakes in Florida. If you came here from a state that didn't have them, which I think all the states have them, we have quite a few. Found this one in my garage a couple years ago. And I like showing a picture of it and not telling you. I actually trapped it with a stick, but I picked it up later when I knew I could get it, so I wasn't quite as brave as that looks. But can you imagine my little girl hungry and say to me, Daddy, can I have a fish to eat? And I hand her that thing. In case the rock and the snake don't make his point, when he told this in Luke with his disciples, he elevated a little bit. He said, who of you, if your son asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? It's ludicrous. Like, why would you do that? Why would you treat your child like that? Even worse, why would you think God would do that? That's what Jesus is saying. Who of you would do this? Why would you think the Father would treat you this way? Brennan Manning, late Brennan Manning, wrote in his book, Abba's Child, he said, so we unwittingly project onto God our own attitudes and feelings toward ourselves. Thus, if we feel hateful toward ourselves, we assume that God feels hateful toward us. You ever thought about that? Catch yourself doing it? You look in the mirror and you have that little set of voices in there that go through all the list of, you idiot, stupid, ugly fool. And you think, God's not like that. But we tend to project that onto him. I guess he sees me that way too. See how twisted that is? God's not like your worst thoughts about yourself. He's not like your worst day. He's not the voices that say you did it again, or you're as worthless as they said you were, or you're stupid, or you're ugly, you're a failure. He's not that kind of father. When I rewired my mom's old hairdryer, because I had mastered electricity at 9 years old, which I hadn't, I didn't wait for my dad. I didn't know if he would stop me, be mad at me. I wasn't sure, so I just plugged that thing in the wall. Sorry, I went too soon. The sparks that came from that outlet on the carport of my mom's house put char marks on that outlet that are still there to this day. Then I had to wait until Dad got home. And he realized some of the lights in the house were not working. And he wondered what had happened. I just plugged it in this one. I don't know what happened to all those others. Apparently, I blew a fuse. And that's not a breaker. That was a fuse. This is the 1970s. This took a little took a second. There's enough time for sparks to shoot out before it finally killed the circuit. We had fuses. But it didn't go as bad as I thought. I think he was a little impressed by the audacity, really, and that I was alive. I lived through that. I've been shocked a handful of times in my life. I actually didn't get shocked that day. But he was a man. He was just a human man. And he would never give me a scorpion when I needed an egg. My father would have never given me rocks when I needed bread. If then, this is Jesus talking, if then you who are evil... It's good now and then. Jesus just shoots straight. Hey, just so we're clear, you're not God, and you have problems. If then you who are evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? If even your human dad knows the difference between fish and snakes, don't you know that God does? I mean, after all, you're evil. You're corrupt. Your heart is conflicted, confused, chasing for acceptance and comfort. It's damaged. Wendy and I, a couple of weeks ago, we were at a ranch outside LaGrange, Texas. Every time I say that, I have to haw, 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 haw. Is everybody okay? That'll age me too. You can look that up. We were there with the Center for Relational Care. And it did this marriage workshop thing. It was really, really, really good. We're so grateful we got to go do that. They gave us some new tools kind of for this next chapter in our lives. And part of the process, we had to diagram out our childhood family. And then we got a chart, and we had to score how our parent or family member gave us attention, like leave their world to enter your world attention, to really step into your world. And then how we received affection and who we received that from, and approval. Approval for who you are, not how well you performed, just approval for you being you, and comfort. Not necessarily fight battles for you and provide for you, but actually be able to be there and or to reassure you that everything was okay, that you were okay. And we had to score, some of you score in your families right now. Be really gracious with this. Most did their best and were very affected by how well they received those things. Or your family dynamics were very affected by crises or traumatic events or things that came out of the blue. And sometimes that changed the way things worked. No matter how well that went, we run through life trying to form attachments that validate and meet those needs. Trying to be secure in our identity and who we are, to know that we're okay. God doesn't do that. He's not damaged like us. He loves perfectly, out of a place of perfect security. Out of being full, he can love us without needing anything from us. And he does good toward you. He wills good toward you. He gives good things if you ask. Jesus says, how much more will your Father in heaven give good things to those who ask? Doesn't always mean it was the thing you wanted, but he'll do good toward you. He knows what you need. And as you get secure in that, you form your identity in him and in what he tells you. And he tells you things like, you're made in my image. You're made in my image. You're valuable. You're important. You're wanted. Then, as you're secure in that, you can love people without needing things from them like he does. Because you have a good father. He's a good father. And he knows you. He knows what you need. He would never give you a rock when you need bread. Jesus just said that. Why would you even think of him that way? We think of him that way because we're evil, because we're twisted. We have experiences of people who treated us like that, or we fear that maybe I'd treat me like that because I know what I deserve. He's not like that. He's good. And that would be a great place to end the passage, right? You could stop there and apply and think through how we treat other people in our life. What are the things I'm chasing? Where's my security? Where do I find my identity? Is it in things the world tells me that matters? Or is it in God's word saying, you were made in my image? You are mine. But Jesus didn't end it there. He said something next that the whole world heard. Something that others had said throughout history, but it always said it in the negative, and certainly not used it to describe God like Jesus does. The last verse there in Matthew, Jesus says, so whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them. For this is the law and the prophets. This sums up. Let me sum up the Bible. Let me sum up the character of God. And then Jesus speaks the golden rule. Treat others the way you wish they treated you. That had existed in other places historically. It was always in the negative. Like, don't do what you don't want done. Jesus flips it in the positive. Do how you want to be treated. Flips it around. Treat people the way you wish you were treated. God is good to you, so therefore, be good to people. He uses it at the end of this passage. He's talking about what kind of father God is. And then he says, so, treat people this way. Because that's what your father is like. He knows what you need. He would never trick you or give you something harmful. The time Jesus taught this in Luke, I mentioned we're in Matthew, when he was in Luke and he's just talking to his disciples, he adds something. Matthew says God will give good things. He says, how much more then will your Father in heaven give good things to those who ask? But what is it you really need from God? What's the thing? If you ask, you seek, and you knock at the door of God, what is it you need most of all? What do you need so that you can be secure in your identity, so you can function out of a place of knowing who you are and where your value and your worth comes from? Above everything, when you were a kid wondering if dad would give you attention or affection or approval or comfort, what did you really need? Did you just need some kind words or time or gifts? Those things may have helped you understood dad. I would argue what you really needed was dad. To be there. You needed to know that he was there, that you weren't alone, that he won't leave you. He will continue to be there. Some of you never had that. You were never sure if dad would stick around, or you're not completely sure if you wanted him around, depending on what he was like at the moment. Maybe you never even knew your dad. I'm sorry that happened to you. But God's not evil like people. He's good. He's a perfect father. And when Jesus teaches this with his disciples over in Luke, instead of saying God will give you good things, he clarifies, if then you who are evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? What do you need above all? You need to know you're not alone, to know that your Father is there, that he will be there, that he's for you, that he will not leave. Jesus says if you ask, God will give you himself. the Holy Spirit. He will indwell you. He'll come live in you, be with you. This is part of what Jesus accomplished for us through the death and resurrection. He pays for sin. So when you turn to him and ask him to take your life, Lord, take my life, save me, he cleanses you in a way that makes you the place the Holy Spirit can live. He makes you a temple. He can come live in you and be with you, always with you. We get this crazy promise, if you'll ask, God will come into your life and stay there. We read over in Hebrews where he says he'll never leave or forsake you. He'll stay. What kind of father is God? This is what Jesus was answering. He's a patient father. He listens. He has time for you. He's a willing father. He wants to give you good in your life. He's a good father. He loves you. He accepts you. And he is a present father. He will be there, always there. I mentioned that over in Hebrews 13. It's another one of my favorite verses where he tells us, for he's told us, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Once he comes in, once you invite him in, once you ask, once you knock, he never leaves. Heavenly Dad will always be there. He's patient, he's willing, he's good, and he's present. I mentioned in that retreat Wendy and I were at, those core needs that we had to evaluate in our own lives and how they were met in childhood and how they were met by people. How does God stack up on this list? If Jesus says, if you'll ask, he'll give you the Holy Spirit, he'll come live in you, how does he stack up? Is he patient? Does he have time for you? Kind of what he taught, wasn't it? Is he willing? Does he want to help you? He's good. He wants to help. He wants to give good to you. And he's present in the worst moments of your life. Would it have mattered if your dad had been there for you in that moment? If you knew that you could count on him in the worst moment, that he would be there and bring comfort no matter what, that he would never leave you or forsake you, would that have mattered? This is the promise that we get from Jesus, that he will do that. He will be there. He's not like a human dad. He comes from a place so much greater. He's the one that we need. He's where we get comfort. He is the good father. He's the kind of father that you run to when you screw up, when you wake up, when you go to work, when you come home. You may need a minute now to go to him. Maybe this is the first time in your life you realize that he's for you. We get these words from Jesus that tell us what he's like. He's not like whatever fears you project onto him. He's good. And if you knock at the door, he'll open it and bring you in. You don't have to fear him. Jesus said, if you ask, he will answer. If you seek, you'll find. If you knock, he'll open the door, and if you ask him, he will give you the Holy Spirit. He'll give you himself. So can I pray for us and take a moment where you are? You may need to reflect on what it means for life now to know that you have a good, perfect Father who says he will be there always, that he wills good for you. You may need to ask for him to come into your life. Some of you have never done that. Jesus makes some incredible promises. This is one of those. If you'll ask God to save you, he will. You can put your trust in Jesus, and God will do that for you. And then these promises are true for you. He'll give you his Holy Spirit. He'll come live in you, and he'll be there. You won't ever be alone again. Can I pray for us? Father, I'm so grateful for the words you taught and for the picture Jesus paints of you, where he helps us answer this question. What do you like? And makes us wrestle with why don't we run to you? Why don't we come to you? And God, I pray that you just break down the walls in our lives, the things that make us wonder if we can really trust you, wonder if you really see what we're going through or what life has been like or what we're facing. And I'm grateful for places where you say, yes, absolutely. God knows what you need. And he'll give you himself if we just ask. And Lord, I pray that you just go or comfort in that. Those of us that have some barriers up from wounds or unmet things in our own life, Lord, that you would do what you need to do to draw us to you so that we could come and know you and learn that these things are true about you. For those, God, that have had experiences that make them question whether or not you're good and whether or not you're there, pray that you just give them confidence in the words of Jesus. You draw them to a place where they'll seek and ask and let you open the door. And teach us, Father, we can trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. Over in 1 Peter, it says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Amen. Amen.